Thank you very much, Anuj, for this very nice introduction. First of all, congratulations on such a successful meeting. And I'm sure there'll be a lot of take-home messages from this meeting for a lot of doctors. So congratulations to you for this. And I'd like to thank Novo for giving me this opportunity to speak over here on this subject, which is of quite importance as of now, because we're looking at new metrics for glucose monitoring. And conventionally, we know that we have been talking about point of care testing, then we moved on to HbA1c. And now, of course, we're talking more about time and range as our metric for, you know, for assessing good glycemic control. And perhaps one doesn't replace the other, and we need to see in totality how all these three metrics complement each other. What we are really looking today in my lecture is basically how does insulin play a role in getting patients to better goals in terms of time and range. How do I change my slide, please? On the screen. First one. Okay, thank you. So these are the financial disclosures, and I'm going to start my talk about a little bit of introduction of time and range and its implication. Here you know you have two patients, both of them with identical HbA1c. But the difference between the two groups is what you look at is the variation of glucose control in both of them. So what the, if you look at the upper graph, the, this patient has got a lot of glycemic variability and yet an A1c of 8%, whereas the second patient has got a lower glycemic variability and yet has an A1C of 8%. But what is matters is basically the patient who's up swings between hyper and hypoglycemia. And here in the second patient, you find that these episodes are lower. We know now that one of the reasons for all complications of diabetes is glycemic variability. And if we can minimize this glycemic variability, then obviously our patients are going to do much better. All right. So what do we really mean by time and range? It refers to the idea that what is the percentage of time in a day a patient is between the range of 70 to 180. And that is basically what we call is a good time and range. And majority of our patients should be within that range. And if you want to look at tight glycemic control, then the patients between 70 to 140 is the target that how much time they spend in this range. We also talk about time above range and below range to indicate hyper and hypoglycemia. And time in range may be more appropriate endpoint for clinical research as a measure of glycemic control in patients with diabetes. There's now, of course, a lot of emerging evidence that time in range is inversely correlated to risk of developing micro and macrovascular complications. And I will just present some of the data in some of the coming slides on this. All right. So there was just recently published in 2019, the International Consensus Report on Continuous Glucose Monitoring and the concept of time and range. And the purpose was basically to give a unified guideline on and recommendations for clinicians, researchers, and patients with diabetes on the use, interpretation, and how to make decisions based on CGM data for effective diabetes management. And this was, of course, based on the fact that in 2012, there were the first recommendations by the expert panel on standardization of CGM metrics. And in 2017, there were various publications in CGM metrics and data to evaluate, but there was no formal adoption by professional organizations and applications in clinical practice. So finally, in about in 2019, the international consensus at ATD to develop CGM targets based on currently agreed upon CGM metrics. All right. Now, what it really points out in this graph is basically most of our patients should be within the range of 70 to 180 majority of the time. So more than 70% of time, 16 hours and 48 minutes is basically what they really actually quantified. And the time that somebody can spend below and above range has also been specified. So above 180 and 250, how much is allowable time in a day and below range, of course. Our endeavor should always be to see that we should try and keep majority of the time on majority of the patients within the target goals of 70 to 180. Based on the various studies, it has been shown that each incremental 5% increase in TIR is associated with clinically significant benefits for type 1 and type 2 individuals. And we'll see that in the coming data. Now, there have been also sort of, you know, categories of patients where we may need to make some adjustments. So in the older patients, you want to see that patients are lesser sort of tightly controlled for the risk of hypoglycemia. So you shift this time in range to see that majority of the time the patient could be between 140 to 180 rather than go down all the way up to 70. So then you make these adjustments to see that the patient's goals are a little more relaxed and to avoid hypoglycemia. Whereas in pregnancy, you want to have more tighter controls for the benefits on the fetus. So you want to see that majority of the patients are in tight glycemic control so that you can achieve an A1C target, which is recommended for GDM and pregnancy. There is a correlation between A1C and percentage of time in range. And this has been quantified that if you look at the right side of the table, you see that 10%, 20%, 30% is the equivalent of what you see in A1Cs. So this is very similar to what we call about estimated average glucose, where you equate the HbA1c to estimated average glucose. And here you've got time in range, which has been equated to HbA1c. But what is important is to understand, for every absolute 10% change in percentage of time in range, there was approximately 0.8% reduction in the A1c values. So here you can see the correlation between time in range and microvascular complications. And clearly you can see from this bar diagram that for every 10% less in time in range, the retinopathy progression increased by 64%. And very similarly, you see the progression even in microalbuminuria, that 10% less TIR causes a progression to be increased by 40%. So there is a very good correlation. And here you find there's a correlation between the carotid intermedial media thickness and for significant association in TIR and CIMT, which could become a predictor for future cardiovascular events. So for every 10% increase in TIR, there was a 6.4% lower risk of abnormal CIMT. And here they've sort of shown the association between time in range and MACE events. And here you can see that they've tried to see above 70% versus below 70%. So all those, this is from the derived time in range. This is from the SMBG. Basically, they do a derived time in range. And you find that if you can keep your derived time in range more than 70%, there is a 27% reduction in the risk for MACE. And if you compare derived time in range more than 70% versus less than or equal to 50%, there is yet a 31% reduction in MACE. And when compared between 50 to 70 versus less than or equal to 50%, there is a 9% reduction in the occurrences of MACE. And this basically was maintained when analysis was adjusted for all the baseline characteristics. Here you can see basically a 10-year cumulative incidence of developing diabetes-related complications after improving time in range. And here they've looked at sort of three targets, 58% TIR, 70% and 80%, both for type 1 and type 2. And you look at the endpoints, whether it's myocardial infarction, end-stage renal disease, severe vision loss, or amputation. You find that when the patient is 58% in TIR and compare that against 70% TIR, you find a very significant reduction. But when you go from 70 to 80, there's not much of a significant change that you really see. So there is that's why the cutoff point of 70% that you really see, and whether you see in type 1 or type 2, and across all the endpoints of occurrences, whether you look at all the, you know, myocardial infarction or ESRD or vision or amputation. All right. My second point is, of course, how do you really visualize the benefits of neuro analogs through time and range? And this is basically the time and timeline of action of degludec. You can clearly see this has been compared again, U100 glargine. The mean half-life for degludec, irrespective of the dose that you use, whether it's 0.4, 0.6, or 0.8 units per kilogram, the half-life, the mean half-life is about 25 hours. Whereas when you look at U100, whether it's 0.4, 0.6, or 0.8, the mean half-life is 12 hours. And if you look at the right side of the graphs, you see that there is a flat action curve that you see over here with no peaking effect. So that proves that there is a good uniform glucose lowering effect that is present throughout the day. All right. And this actually happens with very minimal or no glycemic variability. So here they've compared degludec versus U100 and U300. And you can see here that there is there's no peaking effect of degludec, and there is no variability that you can see in action between the degludec and U100 or U300. And here, through RCTs and real-world evidences, they have shown a consistent efficacy in hypoglycemia, the comparator being degludec versus U100 or U300. And if you look at the RCTs, whether BEGIN, SWITCH, or DEVOTE, these are non-inferiority trials, and you can see that A1C was comparable, but the reduction in fasting plasma glucose and the dose required for achieving targets was much lower with degludec when compared against U100. And the rates of hypoglycemia or severe or nocturnal hypoglycemia were much lower with degludec when compared with glargine. And then if you look at the real-world evidence, you find that there's a clear benefit with degludec when compared against U100, Detemir, or NPH in the different studies. And even when you switched insulins from one to the other, and the patients were switched from glargine to degludec, you found that the benefit continued to improve when patients were put on degludec. But this is a very important study, the SWITCH Pro RCT, and there they compared degludec versus U100. There was an initial screening period, run-in period, and then the patients were put on flash glucose monitoring for 2 weeks. That was the baseline flash glucose monitoring data. And the randomization happened between two groups, that's degludec once a day with the baseline oral agents versus glargine U100 once a day at the background of oral agents. And then after 16 weeks, they were again put on flash glucose monitoring. And at the end of 2 weeks of flash glucose monitoring data, they were then interchanged. So the patients who were on glargine were switched to degludec, and the patients who were on degludec were switched to glargine. And then they had another 16 weeks followed by 2 weeks of flash glucose monitoring data. So here you find that they were trying to see the benefit between one with against the other. And when they were shifted from the interchange, did the benefit continue or what happened to the benefits? And here you can clearly see that the time in range where degludec was, when it was compared against U100, there was an estimated treatment difference of about 1.43%, or 20, almost 20 minutes of the patients in the day were more in time in range when the patients were on degludec against U100. Similarly, if you see here, the overall tight glycemic range, that's the between 70 to 140, you found that patients were almost about 22 minutes of the day more in time in range between 70 to 140 when patients were put on degludec against U100. Here you're looking at basically more when you compare degludec versus glargine, what were the improvements in time in range? And you can see clearly that almost 37% improvement with degludec as compared to glargine that was seen when patients were put on more tight glycemic control. What about patients below time in range? So time below range, you found that there was a lesser number of patients or lesser time that the patients were in time below range when the patients were on degludec when compared against U100. So I'm going to end my talk here, and I hope I've kept to my time limit, that in summary, time in range provides a complete visualization of the patient's glycemic status and aids in better glycemic control. Increasing time in range has shown to reduce microvascular and macrovascular complications in people with diabetes. And when you compare degludec versus U100 glargine, there is an improved time in range. Superiority is confirmed. There's an improved tight time in range that's between 70 to 140. There's a lower time below range, level one and level two. And there are more patients who achieved clinically significant improvement in time in range. So thank you for listening very patiently, and thank the organizers for inviting me here today. Thank you very much.